The story. Jesus and his disciples moving south through the land of Samaria, arriving around noon under a blazing hot sun and a cloudless sky into the town of Sychar. Disciples go forward to grab something for lunch. Jesus blesses them on their way and sits down beside the well, hopefully with a bit of shade. And then a woman comes to gather water for herself, and he asks her for a drink. We need to pause just for a moment and to recognize that there is something strange about a single woman coming at noon to the well. Tradition is always that you come in the early hours of the morning when life is fresh, when you actually need the water, when it's cool. And all the women will come carrying their jars upon shoulder, and they will gossip and be together, gather the water for the day, and this woman is not welcome to be in their midst. We will hear later that there may be some suggestions that she was not quite the kind of woman that every proper matron of Sychar would want to hang out with. She has had 5 husbands, and Jesus said, and the guy you're living with now, he ain't your husband. Colloquial, shacked up. It could have been that she was just unlucky in love and managed to kill off 5 good men. Could have been that she was divorced several times and as a divorced and therefore single woman in first century had no means of making a living and became a sex trade worker. Probably wouldn't have used that terminology, but that might be the reality. She was a woman of some character and therefore found herself alone. I ask you just for a moment to put yourself into her shoes, her being, recognizing that so often in John's telling of gospel stories, a character wanders in who represents the hunger or the thirst or the need of every one of us. This is the person who doesn't quite fit in, who for whatever reason doesn't always feel at ease in the group. Maybe you are a bit shy. Maybe you are new to the country. Maybe your skill at English is not as quick and speedy as those around you. Maybe you have a history that you're not completely proud of. Maybe you carry questions and pain saying, I'm not sure I should hang out in church because I have so many questions, I don't really think I belong here. Maybe you are someone who carries a weight of some guilt for what you have done or not done with your time and your years. Maybe you are someone who struggles with issues of self-esteem, like, am I worth anything? Is there anyone in my community, in my circle, in Carisdale, in Westside, somewhere who will affirm that I am someone of value, that I am loved, or will you be the person who shows up the center of town at the wrong moment by yourself when nobody else is there for you? I think this woman of Samaria, this outcast, non-Jew, woman of reputation who finds herself alone is so much like any one of us, so thirsty for community, for acceptance, for belonging, for connection, for meaning and for purpose. And Jesus recognizes that hunger. A man of wisdom, a man of insight, a rabbi of sensitivity, and he says, give me a drink. This woman, she's smart. She's not a docile, oh, yes, sir. I love her because she snaps back the question and says, why are you, a Jew, talking to me, a Samaritan, and above all, a woman? She is perhaps an SBNR kind of person, spiritual but not religious. Someone who comes with questions and will not take an easy answer even from a wandering so-called accepting rabbi. She pushes back and forth, and Jesus lives with the question, almost invites the question, and then says, give me a drink of water, the same for you. I will take this water, and you will receive this gift. Makes me thirsty, doesn't it? Just watching me, even wasting a little of it. This is, said Jesus, the water of life, a symbol, a metaphor, trying to say to this woman, to each one of us, what your heart is thirsty for is available for you. It is grace. It is abundance. People around you may not recognize that you are a beloved child of God, made in the full image of the Holy. I do. And I offer you this water. Call it water from the rock. Call it water of baptism. Call it the water of life. Call it the water of the flowing river. It is yours. And she says, give me this water that I might drink, acknowledging the thirst of her very soul for this connection, not just a drink in passing, but a connection to that which gives life, that which is holy, that which is all around and surging through the reality of being, but seems sometimes to be restricted or cut off or held in the hands of those who assume they have the right to give the water. It isn't just water, is it? We can drink, we can say metaphor. What that woman is thirsting for, what I suspect all of us at some time in our life are thirsting for, is something even deeper than quenching passing thirst. We are so hungry for love. We are spirit hungry for a fullness of acceptance, for where we might belong, for community, and for what lies under community, a sense of the deepest love that will not let us go. That's what we're thirsty for. My soul is thirsty for you, O Lord. Thirsty, O Lord, for you. My soul is parched and dry as in a desert land, and I, O God, am thirsty for you. Let me shift the metaphor and add another word. My soul is thirsty for love. Not the romance of gloss and movie culture that we are so familiar with, but the love that is deep and ever-flowing, that pulses from the heart of, well, we say God, but whatever it is in which we live and move and have our being. A poem by Raymond Carver, a short poem called Late Fragments, from his final collection of poetry entitled To the Waterfall. He wrote it knowing that his days were limited as he lived with and was dying from his cancer. And this little poem says, and did you get what you wanted from this life? Even so, I did. And what was it that you wanted? To call myself beloved. To feel myself beloved on this earth. That, I think, is the deepest thirst of our souls. To feel ourselves beloved. To feel it so strongly that we can call ourselves, acknowledge it, that we are beloved. Some of us might be blessed with a partner, a friend, a lover, a parent, a child, a family, a community that gives skin and flesh to this reality. Some of us, like a Samaritan woman with five husbands gone and a man she's just living with, maybe there isn't the flesh except when she meets this rabbi. Maybe it comes just from being in the world, and you feel the amazing wonder and energy of creation all around and recognize that there is God and you belong and you are loved. Last Wednesday night, Tim and I were down at the Sylvia Hotel, just a couple blocks from where we live. We call it our pub. During the summer, we look askance at the visitors, but we have a welcoming tendency as long as we have our own table. We were sharing a lovely glass of wine, deep in conversation. On Wednesday nights now, at the Sylvia Hotel, they introduce jazz. You can see some people who are into serious drinking and view-taking aren't all that keen. I love jazz. And a beautiful bass player, pianist, vocalist, suddenly began to sing Nature Boy by Eden Abbas. And I said to Tim, shush! Conversation stops. You are trumped by jazz. Hold that thought. Many of you will know Nature Boy, made famous first of all by Nat King Cole. It is a Jesus song. It is an absolute Jesus song. Although those who first hear it think, oh, this is cool. This is jazz. This is the bar. This is scotch. This is cigarette smoke. This is all that Samaritan kind of stuff. But it's a song that talks about our deepest thirst. There was a boy, a very strange enchanted boy. They say he wandered very far, very far, over land and sea. A little shy and sad of eye, but very wise was he. And then one day, one magic day, he passed my way. And well, we spoke of many things, fools and kings. This he said to me, the greatest thing you'll ever learn is to be loved and to love in return. The greatest thing you'll ever learn is to be loved and to love in return. To call ourselves beloved and to feel ourselves beloved on this earth, this place, this time. The greatest thing we'll ever learn, says Jesus, is to be loved and to love in return. Easy enough for a preacher guy to say that on a Sunday morning. You might hold on to the line. You might realize how thirsty, how hungry you are for that touch, that spirit. But how do you get there? How does it happen? I think that's one of the reasons we hang out in a community like this, to figure out what are the practices, the disciplines, the pathway that might allow us to catch moments of that love, to quench our thirst. It's not always easy. On one hand, it's the easiest thing in the world. Just be. Whoever this little one-year-old is in our midst, whose grandmother is coming up because of me, but because of the granddaughter, that little person knows how easy it is. Just love me. The little person that was up here, I saw her with her dad coming in the rain. She knows what it means to be loved. Most of us forget somewhere on the route, and we have to relearn. So another poem, it's called Lightening the Load by Frances Dorff. And she writes and says, the first thing we have to notice is how we load down the camel with so much baggage, we'll never get through the desert alive. Something has to go. So then, knowing that, we can begin the hard work of dumping the thousand and one things we brought along until even the camel has to go. Even the church building has to go, sir. Even the camel. camel has to go, and we are left walking barefoot across the desert sand. Who knows what might happen then? But I've heard that some people walking in this way have seen a burning bush. The task for so many of us is to start letting go of the baggage, the stuff, the accumulation of things and prejudices and set ways of thinking. You look at the bestseller list now in North America, books on a decluttering are high on the list. I forget what percentage it is of Americans, wouldn't be Canadians, but perhaps, who have so much darn stuff they have to rent storage containers because it won't fit in their house, and I want to think, you haven't got a hope of discovering what it means to be loved. You are so well protected, so well defended, that God's Spirit has a hard time just getting through in between your accumulation. There are our preconceptions, our protections, the ways we've handled life that have gotten us through, but haven't allowed the water to come pouring over us and into us. We need to risk vulnerability. We need to simply be open. We need actually to ask, to say, oh God, my soul is thirsty. I need the water that you can offer. I've been relatively successful at the Batman grandkids I've heard. Hey, I'm even a moderator of the Meta Church for the next 3 or 4 weeks. And my soul is thirsty. How do we let go and even let the candles go? And what would it be like for you in your life to go walking into the world with the possibilities of seeing a burning bush, which is simply another way of saying receiving the water, another way of saying that the Spirit of Christ be with you, within you. Because you see, that's what Paul is talking about in his letter to the Ephesians. And I have to tell you, there was part of me that said, why in heaven's name, when I have so much preparation for general counsel, did I agree to preach on the last Sunday of July? And then I looked at the lectionary, and I thought the Spirit moves in strange and mysterious ways. The lectionary reading assigned for this Sunday is, in fact, the prayer of Paul, chapter 3 of Ephesians, which just happens to be my favorite passage of Scripture. And it was the passage of Scripture on which I first preached when I was elected moderator and tried to speak to our gathered community to say, this is what we need to hear. It is Paul piling one image on top of another in fancy churchy kind of language. But what he's really saying is the water of life is there if you will just open and pray. And so for 3 years, these words from the letter to the Ephesians has been guiding my own prayer for me, and guiding my prayer for the church, and guiding my prayer for all the people I know. Say, I pray to you, O God, that my inner being, that your inner being, that our inner being might be filled through the power of God, of your Spirit. That one doesn't work. Next line. I pray, O God, that Christ may dwell in my heart, in your heart, in our hearts, through faith, as we are being rooted and grounded in love. Doesn't work. Next line. I pray that I, that you, that we will know the length, the breadth, the height, and the depth of the love of Christ all of us in the communion of saints, oh, God, it's beyond all knowledge. Doesn't hurt? Okay. I pray, oh God, that I and you and all of us, that we might be filled with the fullness of God. What would that feel like? When I was young, I drove my family crazy by singing a favorite song over and over, you know, an earworm that we want to insist everybody else catches. It was a Chris Williamson. Filling up and spilling over, it's an endless waterfall. Filling up and spilling over, over all. Filling up and spilling over, it's an endless waterfall. Filling up and spilling over, over all. That's what Paul is praying. He just says, may we be filled with all the fullness of God. Chris said, may we be filled as if the waterfall of life just floods us, and not only floods us, but then begins to spill out. Because you see, today's story, although we didn't hear the conclusion, does not end with the woman drinking the water and say, oh, I have been blessed. Thank you, Jesus. She says that. And then she leaves and she goes back to the people in Sychar, those who have rejected her, and said, I have just had the most amazing experience, and you can as well. We are beloved. She is actually, in John's gospel, the very first evangelist. Get that? A Samaritan, a woman with a bad rep. And she's the first one to discover what it means to be loved by God, maybe because her soul was so darn thirsty. She is, as David Urich has said in some of his commentary, the other good Samaritan. I like that. And so, on this morning, I invite all of us into Paul's prayer, because he ends by saying to God, who by the power at work among us, within us, is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we can ever ask or imagine. To God be the glory. So when I say, let go of the baggage, ask and pray, this is not one more burden upon you, as in, do the shopping, clean the house, take care of the kids, visit the parents. Oh yes, now, pray and be filled with the fullness of God. Tick. It is to trust that there is a spirit yearning to fill you. And when you catch a sense of being filled, you end up spilling out and over the world. So I want to invite us to finish in a Methodist tradition, which is to invite you into an altar call, but not that you have to move. I can sense the rhythm. Even Richard is like, he doesn't know Dunbar people. We're not used to that. So you won't have to move, but you will have to help me with a responsive chorus. This call is actually a rap song, a rap hymn, written by Chris Giffen, who has PKs on both. He's a PK, both parents are ministers. He didn't have a chance. He wrestled, and he created a Christian rock band, a united Christian rock band, which is almost a contradiction in terms. And this is his song, and he has given me permission to share it wherever I am. You need to work on the chorus, so we'll practice together. The first line, let your whole life speak.
Let your whole life speak.
Let your heart move on.
Let your heart move on.
Set your body free.
Set your body free.
Should your mind hold on.
Should your mind hold on.
We'll do that all together. Let your whole life speak. Let your heart move on. Set your body free. Should your mind hold on. Now, we are people who have middling memories, and sometimes it helps, therefore, to let your body offer the words as well. So there are actions that go with this. Let your whole life speak. And then you take your left hand fist, wrap the right hand around it, put it in front of your heart. Let your heart move on. Your heart just goes out from your center, spilling out into the world. Next line, set your body free. you do an incredible whatever. I have done this in some United Church congregations. I say, oh, that's right. On the other hand, I think Ryerson and I shared this song in a small rural congregation in Newfoundland. And there were several women in the back pews that all went, by the end, they were standing as images of phenomenal body grace in every sense of that. Last one, should your mind hold on. Not that we are anti-intellectual, we should not be thinking, but that we need to let go of set patterns that confine us, that keep the water, the grace away. So all together, let your whole life speak, let your heart move on, set your body free, should your mind hold on. Bring it to the table, bring it in and bring it out. Bring your heart full of passions and bring them down. Bring it as a whisper and bring it as a shout. Bring peace to the center, then bring it all about. Let your whole life speak, let your heart move on. Set your body free, should your mind hold on. Bring it to the table, bring it over, bring it on. Bring the physics of an atom, bring a mystic song. Bring it to your lover, bring it to the throng. Bring it out of hiding and bring it into song. Let your whole life speak, let your heart move on. Set your body free, should your mind hold on. Bring it to the table, bring it new, bring it old. Bring the teachings of your elders, bring the stuff you've been sold. Bring it to the outcast, bring it to the fold, bring your life past the limits of the lies you've been told. Let your whole life speak, let your heart move on, set your body free, should your mind hold on. Bring it to the table, bring it up, bring it down, bring your lips to the water, bring your feet to the ground. Bring it into silence and bring it into sound, bring your blessings and your passions to the beauty all around. Let your whole life speak, let your heart move on, set your body free, should your mind hold on. Bring it to the table, bring a symbol, bring a sign, bring the bread of your living, bring the fruit divine. Bring it to your neighbor, bring it across the line, bring it whole, bring it broken, just bring it, because now's the time. Let your whole life speak, let your heart move on, set your body free, should your mind hold on. Hey, you gotta stand up. You gotta stand up.
Oh, yeah.
Otherwise, your body is just the whole field. So, let your whole life speak, let your heart move on, set your body free, should your mind hold on. Let your whole life speak, let your heart move on, set your body free, should your mind hold on. Let your whole life speak. Amen.